Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Triangle Center for Spiritual Living. So glad you have joined us on this amazingly beautiful day that the Lord hath made. Thank you very much. This Wednesday evenings are 2020 Wednesday, Focused Insight, and the lovely Carol Cross is in the house tonight. We are continuing with our conversations around the book, The Conscious Activist. And I'm just really glad that you're here and that we can be here to just be a part of your lives midweek. Thank you. First and foremost, as we always do, please turn within for a moment to allow ourselves to arrive. Take a nice, deep, collective breath. And sink deeper into that center, the core of our being, that spark of the divine, that space and place of peace, joy, creativity, love, and abundance. I call this space God. I know that it is within me and surrounding me. And just as I know that this is my truth, I know that it is absolutely the truth of each and every person within the sound of my voice, each and every person on the planet, each and every thing, because there's not a place where God is not. And it is from that place of deep and abiding unity that I speak a word of blessing upon our evening, knowing that it is very good, even as it is just beginning. That it is an opportunity to come together, to be in spiritual practice, to deepen on our spiritual growth and expand our conscious awareness, and to allow ourselves to remember that which is back of everything. I bless Carol as she comes forward to allow the words of James O'Day and of God to flow through her. I bless Heather and my own self for being here to facilitate this evening service. And I bless everyone that is tuned in, whether that's on Facebook or Zoom. Just grateful for your presence in this community and for this service. And so for all of the blessings, those that I'm aware of and those I can't even begin to imagine, I am grateful. We anchor this together by saying, and so it is. So we begin this evening with a lovely video created by a family in the UK, and they have put together a song that you'll probably recognize the tune, but a song about their coronavirus experience. So enjoy.
Shut up!
We can't do it.
We just have him out.
Shut up!
Why are you hitting me? I haven't done anything.
Where?
Yeah, you're being loud.
She just hit me all day. That's all she's done to me.
No, I did that.
No, all you did.
He's a bully.
Time one.
nation. Let's just let them run amok. We're not ready for these schoolboys, cause they just don't
give a fuck. One day more,
what can I do? See them on his side, clapping for the NHS to make them cry. Here's a little walk, there's a little ride. Such a need's a bummer when we're stuck in time.
One day to a new beginning.
Big finish.
Oh, I love them. So, hello, everybody. I hope you enjoyed that video.
Good morning. You
may have seen it before, but most of the shows and things that have been doing it, they cut out that first part, and they just have them singing. But it's that first part that is such a blessing. Because when you just see them singing, you're like, man, has my family been wasting their time during the coronavirus? Why aren't we creating John Mulhaney level musical skits? But they had grace enough to leave that part in the front so we could say, oh, the kids are fussing. The parents are saying, just be quiet. They really are like us. Because we are getting into a point, I know we all love our families, but some of us may be feeling we've had a little bit too much family togetherness now. However, what we're going to be talking about today is we're going to have some stories about families that are going to make you see your families like, man, they're the greatest compared to some of these families we're going to be talking about today. But before I start, I want to give back a little context. That we're reading this book, The Conscious Activist, where activism meets mysticism. And by James O'Dea. And the whole point of this book is to say, where is it? We can't have a world that works for everybody using just our spiritual nature or using just activism. So we can't just do our prayers and be in our altars, and we can't just storm the barricades without a spiritual understanding. We need to do both of those things. So it's like we say, treat and move your feet. So this is all about how do you treat and move your feet at a really high level. So last week, Dusty did a great job of covering the whole first half of the book. The first half of the book is about James O'Dea and his journey and what because he's done all these incredible things, both on the spiritual side and on the activist side. And what she went through some qualities that he says that you go through as you are developing these abilities. So starting with the mysticist. So the very first quality that you develop is, he calls it communion. And that's really the definition of mysticism, is that you don't just have this concept of oneness, you have this experience of oneness with the all. And he talks a lot about how that kind of communion is just a great outflowing of compassion. So that's one of the things that he really associates with mysticism. The second is purification. So that is going through some trials to get rid of some of the things that keep us from seeing our oneness with all. Then the next thing is, he says, is guidance. So if you're going to be
somebody into mysticism, you're going to have to be trusting that inner divine guidance instead of guidance from outside or our little brains or those kind of things. So those are your early mysticism qualities. Then as you get deeper into it, the next thing he talks about is commitment. He said, you know, you got to be committed to this. But the commitment is in terms of internal change, that you're not going to just keep doing the same thing over and over again. You're going to change who you are inside spiritually. The next thing that he talks about is discernment. And discernment is like getting to see through the illusion of this physical world to the reality that is the one. And the last thing as a mysticist that he talks about is receptivity. And receptivity is the ability to just like let go and accept what is, despite what your ego attachment thing thinks should be. So that's the steps he talks about going through as in mysticism. As an activist, the number one thing is passion. So activists are passionate about something, some cause, some issue, something that they would like to see done in the world. Second is conscience. The way he uses that is conscience means that you're actually doing something about it. So who cares if you want to save the rainforest if you never take any actions about that? The third is what he calls the activist high horse. And this is one of the hard ones for me. So what he says is that often activists, budding activists or younger activists, they get into a whole position where they are judging people who disagree with them. So, you know, I'm right, you're wrong, I'm good, you're bad, I'm smart, you're dumb, whatever. But that will never work, because that's putting dualism, and it's the old thing of hate the sin, love the sinner. You know, we've got to be dealing with people who disagree with us with, boy, I totally love you, and, you know, I really think we need to do X instead of Y. So those are the initial ones, then, as you go on. The next thing he talks about is naivete, because here's the thing. You got to believe that whatever it is that you're passionate about is possible. And so it can get hard when we have lots of evidence of years and years of war or violence or cruelty to animals or environmental degradation. You've got to have this naivete to think, well, just because that's what's happened in the past, that doesn't mean that's what's going to happen. Next came commitment. So this is, again, you got to be in there for the long haul. And and then the last one is deep understanding, which he really connects back to the receptivity, this whole thing of surrendering to what you're supposed to do as the universe. So the second half of the book is all focused on how we bring these two things together. So we have these two aspects, but how do we live out of both of them? And the very first place he goes is someplace that I love. He goes back to ancient mythology. So he's coming out of the Joseph Campbell, that people who know me know that I use Joseph Campbell a lot in my work, this hero's journey idea. Although he's working primarily with Jean Houston. But the idea from this round of thinking is that there are, from the earliest parts of time, some of these stories that we call archetypal. So we really think of them as being almost like, Jean Houston calls them, the DNA of our culture. And these stories play out again, and these characters show up again, and these situations show up again, over and over and over again, because they're coming from this divine wisdom. So that's the first place that he turned when he was trying to figure out how do we bring this into the world. And he had the great fortune to go to one of Jean Houston's mystery weekends and experience her experiential workshops around myths. But I'm not Jean Houston. So I'm going to do sort of a more Joseph Campbell-like interpretation of a couple of myths that he talks about in the book to see how they give us wisdom about how to approach this topic. And so the first myth that we talk about is the myth of Isis and Osiris, who are two of the primary original Egyptian gods. So Isis is the woman. Osiris is the man. They're siblings because they're part of this first round of hominid deities, so they've got nobody to marry except each other. But they're like the golden couple. Isis is the goddess of heaven and earth. And in a little bit of a twist to many myths, Osiris is the god of fertility. And so he's god of agriculture, he's god of civilization, and he's god of the Nile. Because Egypt at that time, and still a lot now, depended for its entire ability to survive the year on the annual flooding of the Nile, where the floods would bring up all of this good soil because the Egyptian soil isn't that good. So he was pretty popular among the Egyptian people. Now, these guys had a half-brother named Set. Set was the god of chaos. So his symbol was the scorpion, and his realm was called the area of the shifting sands. So you can probably imagine how much prayer was going towards Set as opposed to prayer going to Osiris. So in one of these archetypal things that happens in lots of these stories, the way Set decides to address this is by killing his brother. So he comes and he murders Osiris, and he hides his body. So when Isis hears about this, she is devastated. And the stories say she cried and she cried and she cried so much that her tears overflowed the Nile. But then she's like, okay, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to go find him and bring him back. So she has to go through trials, but she does. She finds his body, and she does her heaven and earth goddess magic, and he revives to some kind of state, at least enough that they conceive a child together. And from their union, the god Horus is born. Now Horus, if you know Egyptian mythology, that's the god that's usually shown with a falcon head. So that's their baby. Now Isis says, well, you know, I know Set's going to come back, and he's going to try and kill the baby, and I got to go protect this baby. So she goes off to raise him in a safe place. She's right. Set shows up again. So what does he decide to do? He kills his brother for the second time. But this time, he's like, I'm going to do it right. And he chops the body up into lots of pieces, and the numbers vary. I like the number 40. And he hides the pieces all over Egypt. And he takes what they say in the story, his phallus, and feeds it to a giant fish. So here's old Isis. So what do you think Isis does? Isis said, hey, I did it once. I can do it again. And she hunts throughout Egypt, and she finds all those pieces and puts them back together again, except that she has to construct a new phallus of cedar and gold, and she puts him back together again, and he revives again to some state. And he's like, you know, babe, I really appreciate this. This is great. I love you. But I can't be the god of fertility if I can't procreate. And she's like, He said, so, you know, seeing as really I'm pretty much dead, I think I should go down and be the god of the underworld. And so Isis agrees, so he leaves and goes down and becomes the god of the underworld and becomes the person who oversees the judgment of each soul, whether they were so evil that they need to be destroyed forever or whether their soul can continue to live in the underworld. Now, Isis is still busy because she's got Horus, and she has to work with Horus because her whole thing is, you know, I can't let the god of chaos be in charge of the Nile. So she raises Horus, and Horus and Set have actually battles for years, and they have one big epic battle where Set pulls out one of Horus's eyes, and Horus damages one of his testicles, and there's a big, huge fight, and finally the gods say, forget it. Horus, you win. You're going to be the new, you're going to take over your father's duties. And Set, you go back to being god of chaos. And so Horus becomes this, he takes over his father's old role. But even more than that, he becomes the sun god. So they believed that what would happen every day is Horus would turn into a falcon and fly across the sky, and his one good eye was the sun. And eventually, Osiris became really beloved, even as god of the underworld. And a lot of the Nile business kind of went back to him, even though he was in the underworld, because of this flow of life and death and rebirth that the Nile goes through. So, I miss everybody, particularly now, because usually my things are a little bit more interactive. But let me ask you, let's just take a couple of minutes and just think about that story for a minute and see how, to you, how it relates to activism and mysticism. So I'll give you just a couple of minutes to think about it, or you can jot down some notes, and I'm going to go over and get my water because I've talked myself dry, while you just think about it for a minute. Okay, so I hope you've had time to come up with a few ideas about how you think that story has divine truth relating to this topic. and there's not one right answer to this, but I'm going to be giving my interpretation of James O'Dea's interpretation of Jean Houston's interpretation of this version of the myth. So in this myth, Isis represents mysticism. And so you see her great compassion by the amount of tears that she weeps. But what you have to realize is she's not just crying over the loss of her husband. She's crying for the pain of all the people who are totally out of luck if Osiris is not here. So her compassion, her ability to connect not only with her loss, but the loss of all the Egyptian people is enough to save the people by overflowing the Nile again and bringing the soil that they need to live. So that's her communion stage. And all those tears are her purification stage. So then she gets to her guidance stage. And she's like, wakes up and she's like, hey, I'm connected with everything. And that doesn't end when they're dead. So it doesn't matter if he's dead. I can go find him. So she uses that divine guidance to find this hidden body. So the next one we get to is commitment. And commitment to interchange. And her commitment is that she has a child. And for many of us, those of us who have children, that's our biggest commitment in our lives. Or at least one of the biggest commitments that we ever make in our life. And because of that commitment, it changes you internally, but it also changes what you're doing on the external world. She leaves her beloved husband in order to protect her child. That's how committed she is. So then we have the discernment part. So there's that great thing about not being confused by the physical universe, that she can find all 40 parts of him through her use of discernment. And then there's that final receptivity where she has to let go of her own desire to have him as her husband and surrender to the fact that this is what's going to be best for everybody, for him to go and rule in the underworld. So there you see a story that is talking about those phases of mysticism. So that makes Osiris the activist, right? So he's passionate about the people. He's passionate about the Nile, about agriculture and all of this. He's passionate about his wife too, evidently. So he's taking all these actions to save the people and protect the people and do all these things of the people. And then you get to the part about the activist high horse. So what's so remarkable about this story to me, and one of the remarkable things, is that in all of this, Osiris never says, oh man, I can't believe Set did that to me. This is so unfair. You know, he betrayed me. Oh, I'm hurt and I'm angry. Or he never did that. You know, he was able to still keep his love for his brother, even though it wasn't working out real well for him in the moment. So then there's the naivete, and I guess maybe that's that he stays there and maybe is giving his brother a second chance. His brother ends up killing him again, but there he was, believing the best of his brother. Then commitment, and this is one of the things I think about activism, is to be an activist, things aren't always going to work out your way. And you have to be committed enough to give up what you wanted to go to what you are, where you're needed. So a great example of that for me is Al Gore, who spent almost his entire adult life trying to become president. And then he lost this election, and very hazy thing. He thinks the best thing to do is to just give up. His best thing for the country is not to fight it. And so he could have gone home and wept and, you know, been bitter about that the rest of his life, but what did he do? He searched inside and said, what am I passionate about? And what came up for him was this whole environmental thing. And so he went on the road, and he was very humble and did all of these talks until finally they made it into a documentary that won Oscars and won Grammys, and he won the Nobel Peace Prize. But that's a great example of somebody who is more committed to making a difference than their idea of how that should look. And so that's what Osiris does. He gives up what they're trying to do what's going to be best for the people and for the system and all. And then let's see, what's my last one? Oh, it's that deep understanding, I've already kind of talked about that. So that is like the illustration of these concepts in a real story. And to me, in this real story, Horus represents actually the integration of both sides. So he's got his mother's mysticism and his father's activism. And to me, that's represented by the fact that he loses one eye. So to me, that means that he's lost that duality that most of us have, that the one eye symbolizes that he has this mystical approach now, but his activities are very much in the activist mode. So that's the first story that we had. Now, the next story we have is from a less known culture, which is the Bushmen of the Kalahari Desert. And for the Bushmen, almost their primary, they have a creator who is a divine, but they have somebody who speaks for the divine, but is divine, but is also human, except it's not a human. So their big person or big creature, spirit, in their mythology is a praying mantis. And when I read this, the praying mantis is almost like a Christ figure, that he doesn't represent just abstract God in itself, but he's a mixture of God and material and or physical, and he's a great vehicle for the words of God. So what happens is the land starts to get terrible. The air is bad, the trees are dying, all this stuff is happening. And praying mantis tells all the animals, oh, you know what's happening? It's the all devourer. The owl devourer has come into our land, and it is destroying everything. And he said, so what we need to do is we need to gather together for supper and prepare. And so all the animals say, okay. And so they all go off to dinner, except for one. And that one is Porcupine. Porcupine, it turns out, has all devour as a parent. So what a great parent to have for your role model. But Porcupine's like, forget it. You can't do that. You're just like giving up. You're just going to go play right into his hands. You know, think about the children. Think about the future. And Praying Mantis is just like, this is what I must do. And Porcupine is like, well, fine. You go do that. I'm not doing that. And so Porcupine has two children. So she takes her two children. She digs a hole. She sticks her children down in the hole. She sits on top of them with all of her spines out. And sure enough, all devourer comes along and consumes every animal in the place, including praying mantis. And poor Porcupine just sees all this devastation and horrible things happening and all of this stuff. But then, after all devourer has eaten all that much stuff, he's like, we all are after Thanksgiving. And he like lumbers over and he's like so full and sated, he like collapses and falls asleep. And Porcupine knows this is my moment. But what she also knows is actually it's not my moment, this is my children's moment. And she picks up her two children. She says, you in the left are compassion. You on my right hand, you are will. And you must go and rip open all devourer. And so the two children, the two little baby porcupines do that, and they're ripping and tearing, and it's awful, and it's bloody, and it's smelly, and it's horrible. But then suddenly they break through, and they see a ray of golden light coming up. And they start tearing it more apart and more and more. And the whole sun rises. And out emerges golden mantis, totally covered in golden light and totally full and fine. And after him trail all of the animals. And Porcupine is like, I can't, how did this happen? And he said, you know, when you're made of pure love, nothing can destroy you. And so the animals all have a big celebration. And that's that story. So I'll give you another couple of minutes to think about the lessons from that story. So I hope you've had enough time to reflect on that one. So that story may seem a little bit more accessible in terms of its integration of activism and mysticism. So obviously, Praying Mantis is the mysticist, and Porcupine is the activist. And what's great about that story is that it shows that neither one, each had their role to play. The Praying Mantis was doing this mystical communion thing where he just surrendered to what he knew was going to be devastation. The Porcupine could not accept that, and she withdrew and was not willing to do that. But neither could have succeeded without the other. So if Praying Mantis didn't have Porcupine, then all Devour would never have been destroyed and a new sunset would never have occurred. But if not only Praying Mantis, but all those other animals hadn't allowed themselves to be consumed by All Devourer, she would never, or her children, would never have been able to defeat him. So there you really see, and she specifically names them, compassion and will, and how working together, these things can bring on a new day, even in the face of things, worlds. And so these may just seem like stories, but the theories of Joseph Campbell and Jean Houston and James O'Day is that, like I say, that these are the DNA of actual events and the stories of our lives. And I would say that that story of Praying Mantis and Porcupine captures a lot of the story of the U.S. Civil Rights Movement. So of the U.S. Civil Rights Movement, you know, the great mysticist was Dr. Martin Luther King. And if you look, read his sermons, I think probably the Bible verse he talked about the most was, "You must love your enemy." And he brought this up again and again and again, that it was not enough to just be nonviolent protests, that we had to love the people who were oppressing us. And he totally saw this union between black people and white people. And he said, you know, this whole inequity, it hurts them, it keeps them down. They have bad effects too. And this rising of equality among black people are going to help white people. And he just preached over and over again that we can never allow our feelings of anger or, you know, all that to have us behave badly. And so Dr. King was also the activist. Dr. King was at the center, and there were so many people who were constantly trying to tell him that what he was doing wasn't going to work. So he had a whole side that was more radical, who thought, you know, you were there, he was doing things too slowly, and he was doing things too normally, and a whole side that said that this nonviolence thing is ridiculous, it's just getting us getting hurt, we need to fight fire with fire. He had a whole side of the civil rights people who were saying, you know, maybe we're pushing too hard, maybe we should slow down, maybe we should cancel, maybe we should... He had politicians, so particularly like the Kennedy brothers, they were very supportive of his cause. John Kennedy told him, basically, look, my first term, I really want to get all this stuff done with foreign policy, but second term, we'll take care of you guys. But to all of these people, he said, no. No, this is not acceptable. No, violence is not acceptable. No, putting this off is not acceptable. No, this is what we're going to do. And but in the story, it is not Porcupine, but her children that fight the battle and end up carrying the day. And I would say that that's true in the civil rights thing too, because who really made things change was not Martin Luther King, but all of his followers, all of his children, all of those people that he inspired to act in this unbelievable way. I mean, it's one thing to have one man who can see that kind of beauty and love for people who are doing bad things for you. But he, if it was just him, the government would just get rid of him, and then that would be the end of it. It was that he inspired thousands of ordinary people to also stand up, to put themselves at risk, because at these things, you know, they would come and they would arrest Dr. King and take him off, but who got all the brunt of all of the anger and the racism and the violence? It was all of his children, his followers. Those are the ones who got beaten. Those are the ones that they sicked dogs on. Those are the ones that they threw rocks at. So that, and when I say Dr. King, there were all other big leaders too, but what really won the day was when the American people saw all these ordinary people acting in such an extraordinarily loving way. And American people, so many American people had been taught that black people were inferior and this kind of stuff. But when they saw so many people acting out of that kind of love that the leaders, you know, the fathers of the movement were able to teach and convey to their children, that's what changed things. So these stories aren't just stories. These are things that play out in our lives, in our real day things. Now, mostly it's not at such a dramatic level, but you can have the same dynamics going on if you are trying to, you know, get a community garden built, or you're trying to start a new charter school, or any of these things, you know, if you're trying to save the rainforests, that it may not be that level of drama, but you see this kind of thing of you need the inspiration, you need the mysticism, and you need those people who are going to put it on the line to make it happen. And it's the integration and the combination of the both of those is when change really comes about. So now we have our meditation. So I will have, you know, a little while for you to think about that and see if any of those characters resonate with you. You know, have you been an Isis or an Osiris or a Horus or a praying mantis or Porcupine, yes. And so sort of think about that, or do you know people like that? And how might you use some of this wisdom on addressing something that you are passionate about? So I'll give you a few minutes to think about that. So I'd like to welcome you back from wherever you've been, back into your body and your conscious mind. And now we'll have just a moment for you to write down any insights or messages or things that you got during the meditation. And if you have any comments that you'd like to share with us, then type it in the feed or the chat box or whatever, and we can respond to them as well. Okay, I'm hearing that there's nothing on the chat to talk about. So we'll go ahead and do our next part of the service, which is the candle lighting. So I ask you to hold in your heart some intention, some desire, some prayer that comes to you around tonight's lesson or around whatever it is you want, really. But so get that in your mind. And tonight we have a mysticism candle. So this candle, this one candle, represents all of your desires and wishes and thoughts and everything out there. So when I light this one candle, it's really lighting up whatever desires or intentions you each have in your individual homes. So get ready, because here it comes.
Let your arms enfold us through the dark of night. Will your angels fold us till we see the light?
So I'm going to wrap up my portion of the evening with a prayer. I invite you to close your eyes and let again this divine stuff, whatever you know it as, whatever you call it, it's energy, but it's substance made from energy, and it is everything and everywhere, and not just physical, but every intention, every story, every thought comes from that one divine source. We call it by different names, but more and more we acknowledge that there is only one. And that one is what I come from. It's what I am. It's what I will always be. It's what every aspect of my life is made up of, that golden divine oneness. But I'm not alone in that. That is true of every one of you, everyone else here at the center itself, everyone and everything in our world and all the worlds beyond worlds that we don't even know about. So from this place of oneness, I breathe in this wisdom that was God's word from the very beginning, and that artists and politicians or leaders, let's say, and people great that we have in the history books and people that we have never heard of. But we're all united through these stories, through this wisdom, and through this intention to combine our oneness and our acts in the world to create the world that we all want, the world that truly works for everyone. So I am so grateful. I'm so grateful for this opportunity. I'm so grateful to have this time to soak into some of this ancient wisdom and approach this topic in so many different ways. And I'm so grateful that I have support in doing that. And I'm so grateful because I know that this is going to make a difference in the world. That's who we are, and that's what we do. And so I know that life will be different because of everyone who participated in things tonight, and I'm grateful for that. But that knowledge, not up to me. I know that the law is going to work it out however it sees fit, however is perfect. So all I do is let it go with our little phrase of love, and so it is. So it is. Thanks.
Thank you so very much, Carol. It's Joseph Campbell, Carolyn Meese, Jean Houston, and Carol Cross, the great archetypal storytellers of the world. We're so lucky to have her here. Thank you very much. It was awesome. It is now time for our conscious giving. And I would just invite everyone to just take a nice deep breath and allow yourself to really allow gratitude to bubble up within you. Gratitude for just how truly abundant we really are. Abundant in so many different ways that, big and small, that just would be too numerous to name in this moment. But to know that our willingness to share of some of that abundance allows us to powerfully step into the flow of life, that giving and receiving are one and the same. And what I know about these gifts is that however big or small they are, they allow this community to continue to do what we do in the world, to continue to be a place of worship, a place of support, a place of communion, a place of love. And that it also, these gifts also expand the one that is giving, expand their experience of abundance, and also expands the experience of sufficiency on the planet for the collective consciousness. And so I am grateful for them, grateful for everyone. Whether you are tithing your time or your talent or your money or just your positive consciousness into the world, I am grateful. And so it is. If you are tithing, so the text-to-tithe number is probably on your screen right now if Heather and I are coordinated together, which she's giving me the head nod. So that's an easy way to do it. You could also go to our website, and up in the right-hand corner of the front page of the website, there's a give button, and if you just click on that, it will take you to the page where you can do that. And I am so grateful. Thank you very much for that. If you would like prayer, Please also, you can go to that same website, Triangle Center for Spiritual Living, and up in the, not quite so far to the right-hand corner, but in that same line, there's another button that just says prayer. And that will take you to a page that you can fill out what it exactly is you would like prayer from us. And that will get to Reverend Betty or myself, and we will make sure that those prayers go out to all of the practitioners and to all of the ministers so that you are supported in whatever it is that you're wanting or needing right now in this moment. If you have a prayer of gratitude, we will willingly pray those also. So please send those in. Speaking of prayer, I would love for you to just turn within one last time so that I can speak a word of gratitude for this evening. Gratitude for these stories and how they can inform us how to be in our lives today, how to take perhaps the budding activists that we are and to deepen that, and then, or the budding mystic that we are and to deepen that, and then to think about now, how can I blend them together to do the highest and the best work that I could possibly do on this planet, knowing that it is the two of them together that can create a world that works for everyone. And for that, I am grateful. And so it is. We leave.